Founder of Current Affairs magazine, Nathan J. Robinson, recently put out a tweet where he was joking about the U.S. government's aid to Israel. And he wrote, "Did you know that the U.S. Congress is not actually permitted to authorize any new spending unless a portion of it is directed toward buying weapons for Israel? It's the law. Or, if not actually the written law, then so ingrained in political custom as to functionally be indistinguishable from law." So, I think it's pretty obvious that he's making a joke, but joke or not, what he's saying here is pretty accurate. I think that it's valid for U.S. citizens to question the aid that they're giving to foreign governments. So, if we can question whether or not we should be giving Saudi Arabia money and weapons that they use to commit genocide in Yemen, then of course we should be able to question the aid that we give to an apartheid regime that is suppressing Palestinians and brutalizing Palestinians, denying them human rights. However, even though Nathan J. Robinson is a columnist at the magazine that he founded, he also writes for The Guardian. However, after putting out this tweet, he received a letter from the editor-in-chief of The Guardian saying this: "Nathan, hi there. As you partly present yourself as a Guardian columnist, allow me to express my concern when you make an assertion such as this. No such law exists in which this is, as one might say, fake news, irrespective of the later tweet when you say that it is indistinguishable from law. It's not law. End of. Given the reckless talk over the past year and beyond of how mythical Jewish groups and alliances yield power over all forms of U.S. public life, I'm not clear how this is helpful to public discourse, and I am not sure why singling out financial aid to Israel in a tweet and devoid of any context and without mention of aid to other countries either, currently or historically, is a useful addition to public discourse. You are free, of course, to use Twitter in whatever way you choose, but it dismays me that someone who presents themselves as a Guardian columnist would make such a clearly erroneous statement without, as I note, any context or justification." Now, Nathan responded by apologizing, and it seemed as if everything was okay. Some time passed, and then Nathan learned that he was fired. He was literally fired because he put out a tweet where he criticized the Israeli government. Now, I do think it is important for us to combat anti-Semitic tropes, right? The Jewish cabal trope is extremely harmful, and it does increase anti-Semitism. But what Nathan is doing here is he is critiquing the Israeli government. Critiquing a group of people is not the same thing as critiquing a government. It is completely legitimate for us to call into question the actions of government, because if we can't do that, then they can get away with anything. Imagine if it was racist to criticize an African country. Imagine if it were racist to criticize Saudi Arabia. You're Islamophobic. I mean, do you understand why this is problematic and nonsensical? So this is very clearly a way to suppress criticism of Israel. That's all it is. And Nathan J. Robinson wrote about this because this actually is a real issue of censorship. And it's not just Nathan J. Robinson who's the victim of this censorship. Mark Lamont Hill was fired from CNN in 2018 for criticizing the Israeli government and standing up for Palestinian rights. He wrote, "Yesterday, I gave a speech at the UN in which I critiqued Israel's policies and practices towards Palestinians. It's baffling how people are not responding to the critique, but instead responding to things I didn't actually say." And what he's referring to is the accusations lobbed against him that he's anti-Semitic. So in other words, what's happening is any and all criticisms of the Israeli government, its practices, its treatment of other citizens, that's conflated with anti-Semitism. And this is very clearly a brazen attempt to shut down criticism when it comes to the Israeli government. Now, what's interesting is that all of the free speech warriors on the right, they never talk about this, ever. They'd rather use some superficial, anecdote related to cancel culture of some leftist being too politically correct and trying to tone police someone rather than calling out a real threat to freedom of speech. And it's not a threat to freedom of speech in the sense that Nathan J. Robinson's First Amendment right was violated. However, he's going to write about how this is bigger than just The Guardian. Now it's enshrined in laws across the country, where you cannot criticize Israel and people are losing their jobs because of it. This happened with a school teacher in Texas not too long ago. Now, in a column about this, Nathan J. Robinson writes, "It is widely recognized that critics of Israel, no matter how well-founded the criticism, are routinely punished by both public and private institutions for their speech. The American Civil Liberties Union has documented a pattern by which those who seek to protest, boycott, or otherwise criticize the Israeli government are being silenced, a trend that manifests on college campuses, in state contracts, and even in bills to change federal criminal law and suppresses the speech of people on only one side of the Israel-Palestine debate. The Center for Constitutional Rights has shown that Israel advocacy organizations, universities, government actors, and other institutions have targeted pro-Palestinian activists with a number of tactics, including event cancellations, baseless legal complaints, administrative disciplinary actions, firings, and false and inflammatory accusations of terrorism and anti-Semitism, and concludes that there is a Palestine exception to free speech. The effort to keep critics of Israel quiet sometimes takes the form of explicit government action. There is an open campaign to criminalize speech critical of Israel, and some states even require oaths from government employees promising to not boycott Israel. But as Israeli journalist Gideon Levy notes in the Middle East Eye, it often comes in the form of baseless and offensive accusations that criticisms of Israel are definitionally anti-Semitic. In the United States, academic critics of Israel have had job offers rescinded or been otherwise kept from teaching, and CNN fired academic Mark Lamont Hill over his call for a free Palestine. In Britain, there has been a years-long absurd campaign to tar former Labour leader and critic of the Israeli government policy, Jeremy Corbyn, as an anti-Semite. Human Rights Watch notes that the United States government has wielded unfounded accusations of anti-Semitism against it and against other human rights groups like Amnesty and Oxfam that have exposed Israel's shoddy human rights record. Within Israel itself, the free speech rights of Palestinians are brutally suppressed, and even Jews supportive of Palestinian rights are regularly harassed by the state. Abir al-Nahar of Open Democracy wrote last year about how major mainstream news media outlets are sensitized against any reference to Palestinian rights or international law and any criticism of Israel or its policies. I have noticed that a lot of people who are ostensibly pro-free speech have little to say when critics of Israel are met with professional consequences. Still, my case is a relatively trivial one, and focus should remain on the Palestinians who have been massacred and maimed by Israeli military aggression. The lives of these Palestinians mean absolutely nothing to those who voice more outrage over my tweet than over the actual uses of weapon systems we are buying Israel. The real problem with censoring critics of Israel is that it makes it easier for that country's government to keep murdering protesters and maintaining a blockade that the United Nations says denies basic human rights in contravention of international law and amounts to collective punishment. In 2018, hundreds of Palestinians, including children and medics, were shot by Israeli snipers at the Great March of Return protests. According to the Middle East Monitor, on just one day, the 14th of May, the Israeli army shot and killed seven children and over 1,000 demonstrators were shot with live ammunition. But Israel has never been held to account, and the United States continued to supply it with arms. So everything that Nathan J. Robinson says here is 100% correct. And he goes a little bit deeper. He explains how our government is giving Israel more aid than other countries, and why this really is a serious issue, why it is valid to question what our government does in response to regimes that are doing harm to others. Like, it shouldn't be controversial to criticize the actions of a government. If I criticized the American government and at any time I brought up something I don't like, I'm deemed anti-American, doesn't that just shut down dissent? Isn't that a very obvious attempt to silence my criticism? It's just, this is obvious, right? This is obvious. This is the political correctness. This is the censorship. This is the cancel culture that Republicans have been warning everyone about, except they don't talk about things like this. Real issues related to censorship. They'd rather focus on superficial issues where somebody in the HuffPost wrote a column about how, like, you shouldn't do your hair a certain way, or somebody said something bad a couple of years ago. Like, this is the issue that serious people who care about free speech are going to actually look into. They're going to advocate for people like Mark Lamont Hill and Nathan J. Robinson and teachers who have lost their jobs. But they never do that because these people are frauds. So to all of the Dave Rubins of the world, the Steven Crowders of the world, the Ben Shapiros of the world, the Tim Pools of the world, ask yourself this. Why is it that they never talk about this issue? They seem ostensibly concerned with freedom of speech, issues related to censorship and the First Amendment, but they only seem to care as it pertains to them. So if they were demonetized or one of their friends was banned from Twitter, that is something that we should all care about. But an actual issue that threatens freedom of speech in the United States, something that has led to censorship and firings, what I'm told is cancel culture. Why don't they talk about this? Why aren't they addressing this? It's almost like they don't actually care, and they only bring up issues related to censorship when it's convenient for them. This is a serious issue. This is the hill that leftists should die on if we're genuinely concerned about freedom of speech. Because 9 times out of 10, it is not Republicans who are the victims of freedom of speech, contrary to what folks like Ted Cruz or Diamond and Silk will say. It's actually leftists. It is actually leftists. And I think that the fact that conservatives have basically monopolized discourse with regard to censorship and freedom of speech, that's a failure on our part as leftists. So we need to use examples like this and call out the folks who purport to support freedom of speech and be against censorship. Make them talk about this. Ask them why they're not talking about this. And if they don't want to talk about this, then that tells you that they're not consistent and that they're frauds.